Studio Funk.
This is Hair Kid.
This is QI.
We are Milk Talk, and you are listening to
Studio Funk.
So whilst we're on the topic about the mixing of lyrics of being English and Japanese within tracks, one of the things that we were discussing like privately as well is that talking about when it comes to city pop music, sometimes it is quite influenced from Western music as well. And some of the big tracks from city pop that we all love sometimes are quite influenced what's been going on happening across overseas around that time.
That's right. And I mean, influence is one word for it. I mean, there's definitely creative influence, like people like Tatsuro Yamashita obviously have lots and lots of different influence from American artists, whether it's 1950s kind of doo-wop type stuff, or 1970s. Like a lot of his guitar solos have like an Isley Brothers vibe. Like on Hot Shot, that really sounds like an Ernie Isley type sound. But in some other situations, I don't know if influence is the right word. So I've prepared a couple of songs that, first off, I'll play the Japanese version and I'll introduce it. And then Aswad, I would love for you to guess the original quote-unquote influence track. Are you down? Do you think you can handle it?
Yeah, I'm up for the challenge. This is going to be interesting. I'm ready. Let's do it.
Okay. And QI, I'd love to hear what you think about these tracks too.
So, 楽しみ.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it too. So the first one, this is kind of easy mode. This is Junko Ohashi's I Love You So.
Mm-hmm.
Don't
Okay, so that's a cool track, right? It's hot.
Yeah. It sounds like really like 今っぽい.
It sounds like a really modern track.
Yeah, modern track, but she's voice, she's like a singer style. Mm-hmm. Singer style is a little bit old school. Yeah. It's a little interesting.
Are you familiar with her? Because QI is not as much of a city pop and boogie head as I am, so I'm always curious to see just QI, how much you know. Do you know Junko Ohashi?
I didn't know that, I think, but ちょっと見たことあるかも.
Maybe like on TV or something.
She's an older person, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So probably my parents know her.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, now Aswad. Go ahead.
Okay. Like, I thought the lyric are really scenic. Really, like a site-specific word.
I'm like scenic, scenery, kind of.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Many of the old songs are very narrative. And English and Japanese are very well, like, are well mixed, I think.
Yeah, that I love you so. Whoa, whoa.
Yeah,
it's yeah, it's great. Now, Aswad, I think this one's kind of easy, but any guesses as to the song that influenced I Love You So?
So here I am on the spot. Well, yeah. See, I know this track quite well, and it's a very good track from Junko Ohashi, the track called I Love You So. And the part that always gets me about this track is when it first comes in, when you first hear the first few seconds, you're like, that melody is recognizable on its own. Because I think when you start hearing her vocals on top, it's quite hard to distinguish at times.
Right.
Because then it turns into a full, you know, city pop track, and then it's quite hard to know. But it's one of the things where I can't pinpoint the artist, but I know it's quite hard to do this.
You're going to kick yourself. One more time. I'm going to just listen to the very, very beginning of I Love You So. I'm going to run it back.
Go on, then.
All right. Are you ready? Now, listen to this.
As soon as you play that version, I was just like, it's like I feel sick all of a sudden. I'm like, it's like, of course I know that track.
Yeah, of course.
Of course I do. So that track right there is Chaka Khan with What You're Gonna Do For Me. Oh, man.
That's, I think, probably, for me, that's probably like the stairway to heaven of AOR. Like, probably the best AOR song.
It's
QI, how did you, go ahead.
Go on, QI.
How did you feel about that tune?
Yeah, it's really, I was surprised, it's really similar one.
Yeah, the bass is so close. It's, it's really close.
I really like the second one. Like, what you gonna, what? Like, I really like Shu's singing style. What you gonna? めっちゃなんかダンスボーな感じ。
Yeah, yeah. She's one of my favorite singers ever. Shaka Khan.
I think we need a QI version.
Yeah, is that going to happen? Are we going to do
sing this? What you got? 多分私が歌ったらもっとスウィーティーなチューリングに絶対しちゃう。What you gonna? What you gonna? Something, something.
What you gonna do for me?
Do for me.
Yeah, so...
QI, I love your voice, by the way. It's just like, wow, every time you sing, I'm just like, I'm just here melting. I'm like, oh, this is so good.
Arigato, thank you.
And just to say, like, the Junko Ohashi, I know that track comes from an album called Magical, which is a very well-known album. It's got a blue cover and it's got pictures of the Twin Towers on the front cover. And what's interesting is that album came out in 1984, and I think Shaka Khan was like early 80s. It might have been like 80 or 81.
Yeah, so, well, if I recall correctly, I think Magical is like a compilation, or some of the tracks were released as singles before. So I'm curious as to what actual year I Love You So was from, if it came out on Magical originally, or if it was out before that.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think we need a real-time follow-up.
Yeah, I guess that one did. I don't see it anywhere before Magical.
I don't think it is. It's interesting because I've only known it from that album.
Okay. So I Love You So, I think is exclusive to, okay. Or was Point Zero the compilation? I don't know what I'm talking about with Junko Ohashi. All the City Pop fans listening to this are like, no, it was a Magical track. What are you talking about? You'll be getting like angry DMs. Yeah. Don't listen to Milk Talk. He got the track listing wrong.
No, it doesn't matter. Nanka, sakki no Shaka Khan. The name Shaka Khan is very interesting for me because Shaka is an Indian god, I think. So, nanka, it sounds like the name of the Japanese game. It's like a shooting game, like a Splatoon. And when you hit a target, you say count when you get a hit.
Right.
Yeah, it's Shaka Khan. ってめっちゃ面白い。
Yeah, it does sound like a Japanese onomatopoeia. Like here in Japan, on the menu, they have something called at McDonald's on the menu. They have something called Shaka Chicken.
Ah, yeah, Shaka Chiki aru ne.
Yeah, they call it that because you put the chicken in a bag with seasoning powder and you shake it up and go Shaka 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 Shaka.
Yes.
So. What?
Yeah, so, yeah, that's
Shaka Khan is very catchy for Japanese people. Catchy name.
That's funny.
I'm loving this. I'm loving this insight.
That's great.
To my Japanese listeners out there who listen to this, you're probably like laughing, realizing all these things.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that was really cool. That was really good insight there about the comparisons of Junko and Shaka Khan. And yeah, that's crazy. Mind blowing, actually.
Shall we get a little deeper?
Yeah, let's
do it. I have another comparison. All right, so the first one, this is, I love this LP. This is Hitomi Toyama with Love is the Competition. How do you feel about that song?
Yeah, I was surprised. I thought it was a crazy, well, English song. So suddenly I was surprised to hear the Japanese. I don't know if it's a song in sound or like a current song, modern song, ka, 今の曲か昔の曲か全然あい分かんない。でも、
like it's hard to tell if it's an old song or a modern song.
It's old school.
Yeah, like her voice, she has a really 80s way of singing, doesn't she? To me, anyway. Aswad.
Yeah.
Western influence for Love is the Competition.
So I'm straight away thinking about it's going to be a track, this very hard disco boogie track. Oh, American, definitely American influence here. It's really difficult because there are some groups in my head that I have.
For example, I'll tell you if you're hot or cold.
Okay. Does this come from a group?
It is a group. It is a group.
Okay. Is the group male?
Yes.
Not this has really helped me, but...
Yeah, no, there's like so many male looking groups.
But I can't help but think about a particular group that I have in my head that it may not be this direct song, but I know they have a similar sound when they have like very upbeat songs. But okay, here's another clue. Does this group, who's a male group, they're obviously a bunch of guys, but are they known for doing like also like slow songs sometimes as well?
I want to say yes, but with groups that have slow songs, I don't really listen to them. So, I'm sure that they do have quite a few slow songs. I'm 100% sure, in fact, but I couldn't tell you the names of those tracks.
Right. So this is going to sound like a wild, mad guess here, but this group The Whispers?
Yes.
What?
Got it. Bing, bing, bing. So listen to the intro one more time of the Hitomi Toyama song. Now let's listen to the Whispers track. Are just like one of those top tier boogie groups. So many great songs, and the beat goes on. Even in the late 80s, you had like they did Rock Steady, right? And even Special Effects. I love that song too.
Whispers, they kind of had that formula where they're like, they had hit tracks from every album they did. They were just a hit machine. So it's really funny when I thought about this, like the comparison, because I was thinking about very up-tempo, but also a group that is quite well-known. And The Whispers.
Right, right, right.
So that track right there was Whispers with a track called It's a Love Thing. Oh gosh, the blueprint there is just a is an exact copy.
Yeah, I mean the pre-chorus is different, and the melody is a little different, but that main groove is really close. It's really close.
It's a love thing.
Love competition. Yeah, that one. I don't know if that's just influence or maybe a little more.
crazy stuff.
QI, how did you feel about that, QI?
I love the part where it sounds like a love songs. なんか プリコーラスかな?
Mm-hmm.
The way that goes into the chorus make me just so excited. なんか I feel like I'm going to speed up when I'm driving.
Yeah. A love thing. It's a love thing. This is one of those songs where it'll give you a speeding ticket. And then the officer comes to your car and you say, "No, officer, I was listening to the Whispers." And now he's like, who are the Whispers? But 30 years ago, the Whispers, he'd be like, "Yeah, the Whispers. That's right. Okay, you're good. You can go." All right. So the next track, this is one of my favorite city pop tracks. I think it's right up there with a lot of people's favorites. This is the legendary Momoko Kikuchi with Mystical Composer.
Thank you.
right, here's a hint for you. This original, I believe, was bigger in the UK than in the West. I didn't really know this song, but I think if you look on Discogs, most of the pressings are by a UK, another hint, a female singer.
Right, so it's actually then put on a UK label then. Is that correct? Or is it a label that...
I want to say yes. Let me double check that.
This is tough. I have to admit, this is definitely the hardest one so far. Oh, thing is, I know Mystical Composer quite well, the City Pop record, Momoko, Kikuchi. So,
all right. The original was on EMI with a couple of pressings on Capitol.
Oh, man. Capitol. This is hard.
I mean, EMI.
It's hard. Okay, all this right. is really difficult.
All right.
It's really difficult because I can't hear Western influence in this because it's... Because this Mystical Composer track is a very much a, it's a city pop classic, and it has that city pop sound in that sense. It's very hard.
Those like mid 80s kind of early digital synths with Momoko Kikuchi's voice. It really, I love her voice on this just, record. It's just,
yeah, her voice is beautiful.
QI, what do you think of this song? Did you know this song? Is this like a well-known song in Japan?
I know these songs. But not too famous. Okay. I know that. The track is like a sad rain. So
sad
for
rain.
Me, yeah. For me, her singing style is a little too idol-like. Her lyrics are also very idol. But the sound is too cool. So it's a bit of a contrast, I think.
Oh, contrast?
Yeah, contrast. Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah.
That's true. She does kind of when you get more familiar with the sounds of the Japanese language, you start to realize she's kind of singing like, instead of like saying turntable as tan te budu, she's kind of saying chan che budu. It kind of sounds almost like childish a little bit.
Mm.
But she does have a really beautiful voice.
Yeah.
So
all right, interesting.
Let's hear the song that pretty obviously influenced Mystical Composer, but it does have a different vibe. The vibe is different, but the music is similar. Are you ready?
Let's go.
Yeah.
Okay. Here it comes.
Have you ever wondered why?
I can't believe that.
So close. Are you familiar with that song?
I heard the same song earlier.
Oh, I feel once again, I feel sick. I feel sick. So
that key change of falling in love, you just dream of. That's really close, isn't it?
Yeah. So
not close, it's the same.
Gosh. So I do know this song very well, and it's actually by she's a British soul singer. Her name is Jackie Graham, and she has a track. That track was called Round and Round, and Round and Around, sorry. But it's a record that you can pretty much find anywhere in the UK mm-hmm. as well, because yeah. it's sold a lot of records, I think, and it's quite a mm-hmm. big, it's quite a big song in the UK.
Yeah,
but I don't know. I can't believe that is like the blueprint to probably like one of the best city pop records ever made, which is crazy.
Yeah, I kind of feel that this is actually a really good example of what Western fans of city pop and people who are digging after these records and trying to hunt down city pop songs on YouTube. This is a good example of what city pop tends to offer that Western tracks maybe don't have. The Jackie Graham track, of course, she's a great singer. There's a lot of power in her voice.
Mm-hmm.
And the track is also, it's kind of heavily compressed. It doesn't really pump and breathe. It's just kind of dun 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 across your mind. Like the dynamics, especially, I'm imagining this was around 1984, 85, 86.
Mid-80s,
yeah. Everything started to get a little less punchy. While Mystical Composer, the mix is quieter and it has a more dreamlike quality.
Yeah.
And there's something delicate about it, which for me really is, I guess the word I want to use is enticing. It kind of draws yeah. you in and makes you want to listen to it more. And it's yeah. like, who is Momoko Kikuchi and why is she swimming in a purple pool?
Yeah, it's definitely that dreamy sound. And I think it's one of those things that's always like captivated me about city pop is just that, it just takes you somewhere else that you've never been before, but at the same time feels familiar.
Exactly. Though I will say the chord changes in Round and Around give me goosebumps. Like that when they, I think they go down.
Yeah.
To the falling in love part. That's like a huge modulation that you rarely hear in pop music and it's just beautiful, and then it comes back up to Round and Around. Oh, it's so nice. Love that track. I love both of them. It's like, who's your favorite child? You know, you can't. It's George. No, it's like you can't pick. QI, how did you feel about the second track?
Yeah, so this song is somehow not weird with Japanese lyrics on it. I really mm-hmm. love this melody.
Yeah, both of them have their own power. It's kind of like two sides of a coin. You have like the strong, rich, traditional kind of soul voice.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have sort of the childish, like innocent, but still a little soulful, kind of angelic kind of voice.
Ah, yeah, angelic. 確かに.
Yeah, so, it's... fantastic, great records there, and it's one of those things now that record heads or probably DJs listen to this and I'll be like, that Jackie Graham could be like a secret weapon now. And
and just about a year from now, that's like $100 record.
Yeah, but it's just one of those things, like I said, here in England, in the UK, you can find that record in every record store, and it's just like it'd be available for like £1. It's cheap. Yeah. Like I said, it must have been a very successful record for the label EMI to press so many copies of it.
Yeah. Looking on Discogs, there's editions from UK, France, Australia, Italy, Greece, Netherlands, Portugal. There's a New Zealand 7-inch. If you're a there's an Ecuador pressing. they sent that thing to Ecuador, which is pretty amazing.
That's pretty amazing, yeah.
If there's any Jackie Graham completists out there who want every pressing of Round and Round.
The Ecuador press.
Yeah. Has, you know, that actually might sound more like Mystical Composer because it might have a little less punch and a little less compression, a little more dirt, which I'm a big fan of that dirt. So I know we've spent quite some time doing these comparisons, but I do have one more, which I heard for the first time today when I was getting ready to do these for you. This is a track that was actually new to me. I don't know if either of you are familiar with it. This is Ritsuko Kazami with Uwaki Nakare, which means like a cheating guy, or he's a cheater. Cheating him. It's kind of like broken grammar in English, but anyway. Nice tune, right?
Beautiful. And I'm thinking to myself of like, is that the first time I've heard this? Or I don't know, I feel a bit confused. It feels so fresh to me at the same time.
Yeah, this is a kind of a rare record. I don't think it's been repressed. It's not super expensive. I believe it's from 1987.
Right.
But QI, how did you feel about that song?
Yeah,
had you ever heard that before? I heard it for the first time today. So yeah, this is kind of a Ritsuko Kazami.
It's a really dreamy, I think. So I've been listening to them and I've been thinking that the lyrics are really merged in the tune with the time.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that the way way to sing and what to sing is very much in touch with the time, touch with the ages.
Okay. So yeah. Kind of like what she's singing about and how she's singing about.
How to singing, so.
It really matches like that late 1980s.
Yes, I think that the way listen to Japanese music, so much word singing.
Right, yeah, lots of words really quickly.
Yes, so older songs are more, I feel, the dreamy. Nanka chilling, chotto shika kotoba o kashi o utawanai kara.
Yeah, just a few words and singing.
Mm.
That's right. Now, Aswad, do you have any guesses? Did this ring any bells?
Oh, this is too difficult. This is
okay.
This is the hardest level.
Yeah. Well, this one, I think the biggest hint is the chords in the pre-chorus. Because the main groove, it's like that chord that you hear in many, many different like boogie and AOR and city pop songs. It's probably my favorite chord, the 4 minor 7, where I'm sure we've used it in Milk Talk a bunch. Mm-hmm. So just listening to that, it's kind of hard to pin what this song might be influenced by. But let me run you the pre-chorus one more time if I can find that. What is it? It'll come to you.
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, yes. Friday, Saturday.
Yep, there it is.
Oh, it just stood out to me then. It really like hit me in the face. I was like,
yeah,
of course I know.
Bang, bang. Yeah. So let's have a listen to that. Because QI maybe hasn't heard this song before. How do you feel about that one, QI? Had you heard that before? Yeah. Do you know that song?
Honestly, at first I thought it was my voice.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
oh yeah, right in the beginning the where she's like, sings. It's been a long time.
What memory. I want to hear more.
Right. I have to admit, I'm starting to make a list of QI tracks that need to be done.
Yeah. That song is, it's also good English practice. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, yeah. Friday, Saturday.
It's like Japanese, English studies way.
Yeah, like the best episode of Sesame Street ever.
Yeah, as soon as you got me to focus on that a bit more, it was really obvious. Now, like this song here, this is by Sherelle and it features Alexandra O'Neill, and such a notorious track that this is like worldwide success of a record.
Yeah.
You could probably find a record of this in any record store around the world. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I have a copy. I have the 12-inch. And though I will say, though, after listening to the Ritsuko Kazami version, I mean, you know, this is me from Milk Talk. I love working with QI, but I kind of like Ritsuko's voice a little more than Sherelle on this song. The Sherelle melody is beautiful, but... Yeah. I think Ritsuko is pulling my heartstrings a little more. Again, it's that sort of that delicate, enticing,
yeah,
kind of mysterious vibe that really raises the hair on your arms.
Yeah, the Ritsuko Kazami one is incredible, and I have to now, as the guy that I am, I'm gonna have to like chase this up once we finish this recording.
Yeah.
And probably get my hands on that record there.
Yeah. I think it might be an LP only track. But I hope that, you know, maybe HMV or someone puts that on a 7-inch, because that's a weapon.
Definitely. You'll surprise a lot of people if you play that in a mid set. People just gonna come up to you.
Oh, is this Saturday Love? No. this is Ritsuko.
Amazing. Amazing.
Yeah. So listening to these songs where you hear city pop artists who have taken very obvious influence from Western tracks, maybe too much, you might argue, you might start to be a little heartbroken, like, oh, where's the originality? And where is the unique artistry that I thought city pop had? Happen. And of course, you know, there's plenty of that. Tatsuro and Maria and Minako and Taeko and all of these legends. Tomoko,
legendary,
right?
People, yeah.
A lot of their stuff is, almost all of their stuff, if not all of their stuff, is very, very unique. But on the other hand, I do think sometimes if you spend too much online, some people might almost idolize this 80s music a little too much.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's important for me and my like mental health to remember that the stuff coming out of Japan was very, very, very heavily informed by what was going on in the West.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting because it was a very one-sided conversation. Like, with very few exceptions, you didn't really have, in the 80s, so many Western artists who were taking influence from Japan. The one exception I can think of is Michael Jackson, who wanted to do Behind the Mask by YMO on Thriller, but YMO said, no, you can't have half of our money just because you wrote songs. Just because you wrote lyrics on our song. That's not cool. I know you're Michael Jackson, but that's our song. What are you doing, dude? But with that said, there is a lot of magic in these 1980s tracks, and I want to share with both of you this song. I think this was like a Spotify discovery. This is from a record called Difference by Kenjiro Sakia. And unfortunately, this is the only song I like on the record. The other ones are kind of too fast, like new wave kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But this song is rocking my world right now, so I want to share it with you. This is Ai Sarete Moinai Harem no Tenshi Tachi.
Harem?
harem, like harem, like group of like, yeah, like angels from the harem, and I'm not being loved.
It's a little poetic title.
Yeah, this song. Wait till you hear the music. This is Kenjiro Sakia with Ai Sarete Mo Inai Harem no Tenshi Tachi.
Keep
hot is that?
Yeah, I like it a lot.
I have to admit, I listened to that and I was just like zoning out. I was just like, this is amazing. And I was just listening to every single detail about it.
Yeah, it's got so many layers. It's got that kind of the system type machine groove. But those harmonies in the chorus are like, oh, that's that good stuff, you know?
Amazing. Absolutely amazing.
Yeah. QI, how does that one hit you?
It's like a stylish 90s anime opening. I get it. I think it's because it sounds a little bit similar to Evangelion's theme.
Okay.
Interesting.
Oh, yeah, because Koku no Tenshi no Yoni.
It's a little bit similar feeling.
Yeah, it has that same kind of like upbeat tension. And I think the reverb on his voice is really similar to the Evangelion theme reverb. In my mind, anyway. I could be totally wrong, but yeah.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. That was a treat, I have to say. And definitely put me onto something I was just never aware of, obviously. And it's nice, man. Really, really nice.
I'm glad you dig it. It's a shame that there's not more heat on that record, because even in Japan, you're going to pay at least like $30, like 3,500 yen for this LP, probably more now. And you're just buying it for one song. Everything else, I mean, unless you're like a new wave kind of pop rock collector, but for my funky heart.
The thing is, though, that track is so good. It could be worth it. You just pay for it once and just don't look back and you'll be like,
exactly.
You just have that one track.
That's another one that I hope they put on 7-inch. And that's Pony Canyon. So I don't know if Pony Canyon's been doing 7-inch reissues.
We might have to talk to our good friend, DJ Natoya at Tokyo Condition, and see if he can come up with something.
That's right. Please, Natoya. We need that heat. We need that heat in the crate.
Good stuff.
Yeah. Natoya, actually, when I first talked, I talked to him, I want to say a year or two ago. And he said, yeah, I got Abiru. You got to put Pixelated Girl on 7-inch too. And I kind of feel bad that I haven't. Just because Natoya, in my mind, he's a legend. And if he's saying, press that 7-inch. Yes. Okay. I got you. Natoya, I'm sorry. We haven't done that yet. Maybe that's something that can be talked about at some point.
Indeed.
Magnets shining to catch your eye. Don't want to be part of it.
Yes, don't need to worry.
you for listening. I hope you enjoyed the show. Studio Funk is a monthly podcast which is available on popular podcast services like Spotify and iTunes, but also can be found on other popular music services like SoundCloud and Mixcloud. If you'd like to support the show, you can do at patreon.com/studiofunk, where you become a monthly subscriber, where you receive extra perks and extra content. Extra content includes full tracklist to the show, bonus episodes, giveaways, and a lot more. A special credit and thank you to the subscribers on the highest tier level on Patreon. On the mint tier level, many thanks to Danny Sacedo. That's patreon.com/studiofunk. Thank you. Studio Funk.